today we're going to be working through chapter 7 of JavaScript for R as part of this is part of a book club that we run on YouTube and via the R for Data Science Slack. So this chapter takes a JavaScript library called GIO or GO or something, this is like a kind of 3D visualization thing that allows you to connect points on the globe. So there are kind of examples of the kinds of images you can make on the website. It's a pretty powerful way of viewing global data, I guess. So the past couple of chapters we've been talking about the kind of the typical workflow for getting a JavaScript library such that it's callable from R and you can generate kind of browser embedded JavaScript visualizations based on data that you have in your R session. So these are things that you'd be able to use in a R markdown document in a Shiny app or something like that, such that you can pass data from R to the JavaScript library and generate the kind of interactive visuals that JavaScript's really good at. Typical way of doing this in R is to use a package called HTML widgets, which has been used in the past few chapters to wrap libraries of ever increasing complexity. So the workflow that the author of this book recommends is to kind of start with a kind of vanilla HTML document within which you place the necessary kind of HTML elements and necessary JavaScript code in order to generate a simple visualization using the JavaScript library that you're trying to port over to R. Sorry, not port, call from R. Once you've done that, he recommends kind of generating an R package within which you add the necessary kind of HTML, the necessary functions that you can call from R and that will interact with the JavaScript library. So you initialize an R package, you build a scaffold using HTML widgets tool for doing that, which is create widget, I think. And then, when you've done that, you get a few different files in your R package. One that within which you declare the dependencies of that JavaScript library, one within which you add the kind of JavaScript code that would be necessary in order to, pass data into the appropriate functions of that library, and one and an R script that contains the kind of the functions that you would call as an R user. So you add the JavaScript side code, you work out what data you need to transfer from R to JavaScript, and that's something that crops up in this chapter quite a bit, is like data format of the that is expected by the JavaScript library is not always consistent with the format that you would typically think of as an R programmer, where you're more kind of we'll get into it in a bit, and then add in the necessary R code and stuff like that. So what I've done, I've worked through the example in this chapter. There's a section towards the end, which I don't go into in any detail, where they show how to add kind of a function that can format an existing object. And I can add some notes into the book at a later stage, I guess. So what I've done is I've took the example and I've added it into a repo on my local machine. So the first thing, right? So the first thing that we need to do is to have a look how to call this library from an HTML page. So here what I've done is I've taken, there is a kind of HTML script on the first page of the chapter where it defines how to import libraries and then how to add an element within which you want to put a visualization, and then the code that's necessary to add a geo visualization to that element. The script as it is in the book doesn't quite work, so it's like it's been copied and it's been copied from the kind of homepage for the JavaScript library, and so it recommends to put in this script here where there's a data variable referred to, but that's not actually defined anywhere in the script. So what the code that's in here doesn't work straight off. So I had to make some modifications to the code to make it work. So I've added in a bit of, so this is a kind of array of objects, and the objects encode two different endpoints of one of those arcs, and the kind of the value that connects. So the kind of widths of those arcs that connect here, Canada and the USA. Bigger numbers correspond to bigger arcs in those things. I'll show you how this works if I can find the file. There's examples. Right, so if I open that, it's opened in the wrong monitor. I can probably zoom in. Can I? So I mean, it doesn't look great when I've zoomed in, but this is just connecting. So these arcs connect different countries on the globe. So there's that script that I've just shown, obviously, is capable of making this, I think. So you set up some data, you work out where you want to put your visualization on the page. You initialize an object using that geo library, and then you know add your data and initialize the visualization. So that seems to work, and I kind of had to tweak it to get there, but it seems to work okay. So we've kind of seen the basics of how to use this library. So we created, I created an R package locally. I've changed some of the names of like the function that I'm setting up and the package name that was used compared with what's in the book, just to see if I could find any glitches in the process. What I'll do is I will go to hold on, git check. Oh, have I gone to the wrong thing? Right, okay. So here, this is yes, so here I've added the skeleton for the package and I've added the dependencies for the package. So in here I have the R script kind of template that's added by HTML widgets. In the installables, I have the JavaScript kind of the bare bones of how you would set up a widget from the JavaScript side and stuff. I've added the dependencies that are specified. So there's the 3D JavaScript visualization library and then GIO. The author recommends that you, if, because here 3.js is a dependency of geo.js, it recommends to put the 3 as the first dependency in that YAML file. So since this depends on this, this has to be loaded before this is, and the order in which things are mentioned in your dependency YAML kind of dictates when they will be loaded into your HTML page. So I've added them. Come on. Yes. So there was a script which I've added, well, modified slightly and added to the package. And what it does is it defines the versions of these libraries that we want to download, then declares where in the package to store them and things like that. So we've covered that kind of content last week when Ryan was presenting, so I don't think there's anything particularly new here. So we've generated an R package, added the scaffold for the geo widget, and then ensured that the dependencies of that widget are stored in the inside our new package. The JavaScript side stuff. So I've called my function that I'm going to call from R new GIO. So there's a few things we have to update in here before we can use it. What we're actually going to do first, though, is make sure that the code we've got in the JavaScript file contains all that content that that was in the kind of hello world example that the GIO homepage contains. So sorry. I really didn't want this to happen. Okay. Oh, geez, come off it. Store. Okay, so that's a new file, right? I'm gonna docs for new geo. Empty visualization widget, that's the one I want. Okay. So here I've added the code that's mentioned in the book. Basically, we're adding a GIO controller object into this script in the same way that was present in the kind of plain HTML page version that we generated at the start of the chapter. There were a few iterations of this. So the initial version of it, there was a kind of, we copied over some code that identified the elements on the page into which you're going to add the visualization. And then we had some code that added, that passed in that element to an object that would generate the visualization. When you're doing this in HTML widgets, this factory function here passes in an HTML element as part of its arguments. So that element is actually accessible within the render value function and the resize function that you have in this JavaScript side of an HTML widget. And as such, the element into which we want to add the visualization is actually this same EL element that's a function argument here. So a lot of this was kind of like iterations to show that that was what we needed to do. So really, we can strip down the script to just setting up this controller object and then initializing it. With this, we can generate an empty visualization. The reason it's empty is we've not got any data to add to it yet, but I should be able to run that. And then it was new geo. I'll come back to why that thing isn't there. Right. So here, yeah, we've got an empty visualization. None of those arcs are shown. And if we inspect that, which one was it now? No, that's the sizing. It's this here. Yeah, so we've passed over some data, but the data isn't actually used by the widget code at present. So we have to work out how to transfer the appropriate data over to it such that that can be visualized. So that's fine. So we've done that kind of JavaScript side stuff before. The one of the important points that came through in this chapter was the importance of getting your data in the right structure for its use by the JavaScript library. So at present, my version of this, this is just the template code that HTML widgets provides at the moment. What we're ultimately going to be iterating towards is having the user pass in some data here, that data being wrapped up in an object that gets passed into the JavaScript side, the browser side kind of document so that it can be used. But we need to know the structure of the data that GIO is expecting. So when we when I set up some code that ran this in an HTML page, we had to set up some data that looked like this. So you have a what the letters are for exporting, importing country. So this is exports from Canada and imports into the US. So there's an E and an I element for each entry in this array. And then there's this numeric value that dictates the arc size. So what we're trying to do is replicate this, creating this kind of data structure. Sorry, we're trying to convert some R data structure into a JSON data structure that looks like this. And a few things stand in our way in R, or with HTML widgets. So these are the JSONs, basically, it's an array of a bunch of objects. Each of the objects has an E element and an I element, and they're the kind of ISO 2 country codes, you know, like CN for Canada and US for USA and whatnot. Okay, so there was a... so I just copied the data from this page. So this is the add data method of that GIO object, and they've given you some example data to add into it. Okay, so now if we take this JSON definition and read it into R. So if I take, so this is just a string, it's just a raw string. It's like this new kind of R syntax for raw strings. And that will just take in the string defining the JSON and then convert that into an R data structure. And we'll just see how JSON Lite deals with that. If I post that in here and then have a look at it, it can converts it into a data frame. So so you've got a character column, and then an integer column. So that's converting what the JavaScript side of this library expects to see over into an R data structure. So it seems to go okay that way, starting with the JSON data structure and converting it into the kind of 2D data structure that you expect in R. There is, however, going the other direction, a little bit of a conflict between the style of data sets that you generate in R and how you, after conversion of them to JSON, and what you'd expect to see in JavaScript. So this is like the objects in the JavaScript array correspond to rows of an R data frame. So what you'd be trying to transfer over is an array that contains an object constructed from this row as the first element, an object constructed from this row as the second element, and so on. So we made a few little changes to the function, because now rather than the HTML widget's skeleton initializes the function with a message as its first parameter name. And because we're now transferring over some data, it makes sense to change the parameter name there. Hopefully I've not done anything else hideous in Git. So empty, use L, not container. Add data, that's it. Sorry. Try again. One of my main frustrations with our studio is that I can't copy and paste on the keyboard the same way I would do in the terminal, even though I'm on a kind of mocked up version of the terminal. I have no idea what I've done wrong in my setup to prevent it. So we now have, so the change I've made here has changed that from message as the first parameter. So we're now transferring over some data. So for example, we'd like to be able to call that with the arcs data frame set up like this. We'd want to, if I load all, then I'd want to be able to call it like that. So data equals arcs. Whether that actually works or not is, let's have a see. No, that fails. And the reason it fails is quite interesting. So here, this is the data that was transferred over. X data. So this is the data for that widget there. Sorry, that's just a little confusion there. So if you have a look at it, we've got, the data element of this X thing that was passed over. So X has a sub element called data. That's transferred over to the HTML widget. And within that data, it's an object where you've got an entry for the exporting country, an entry for the importing country, and an entry for the value. And within those entries, you've got one for each row of the original data frame. So rather than like it being an array of objects where one row in the original data frame became one entry in that array, what you've ended up with is an object where each element corresponds to a given column. So you've got the E column has entered the data that was transferred as the first, you know, the value like associated with it. Sorry, that was a bit quiet, Arthur. Could I? I'll just turn up. Try again.
Can you hear me now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. I mean, it's almost a bit like a list, in a certain sense. Like it's judging the. I think it's kind of interesting the problem with the data transfer. You know, it's interesting that, you know, even though you can grab this data from JSON and it kind of converts an R into a data frame, the reverse trip doesn't you know, yield the same thing. So that's kind of one point, which you noted in the notes. And the other thing is, it's interesting that you know, somehow this is being converted almost as like a data frame come like set of lists, like you know, each where each column is a list. So it's kind of treating each column as its own object. So it's almost kind of serializing it kind of column wise rather than row wise.
Yeah, I do think it's quite interesting. Certainly, like the JavaScript sort of side expects the data to be to you know each element in the array should contain all the information necessary to make one arc, whereas the data structure that's been passed over, you need all of the elements of it to make a given arc. You know, if it could be used, you'd need to be able to pull out that first entry of that first entry of that, and that first entry of that to make the first arc. But there are some tools, and the author states that this is likely to be a pain point for a lot of people who are trying to transfer data from R to JavaScript, because more kind of object-oriented languages than R would typically deal with, you know, if you were iterating over something, say in Python or something, you might have an object defining the contents for one arc, and then an object defining the contents for another arc, all in a list. Whereas in R, because you're kind of working in two dimensions, it's quite often that you might work on a kind of column by column basis rather than a row by row basis. Maybe that doesn't make sense. Yes, I'll go back to the document, because there was some other things mentioned in here. Yes, this is a nicer version of what that data structure looks like. So this is what it looks like, and we need to convert that. We basically need to kind of transpose it so that we are row, it's ordered in a kind of ordered by rows rather than ordered by columns. So the next step, so there are a few ways to deal with this kind of data incompatibility thing. So if you think about it, that you could handle it on the R side, or you could handle it on the JavaScript side. And on the JavaScript side, there is a couple of tools. This one's mentioned in the book, but there's actually a couple of other tools that are provided by the JavaScript side of HTML widgets that allow you to convert a transferred data structure to from one form to another on the JavaScript side. So for example, this, what that would do is you would receive the data in this form on in the browser, but then calling this function upon it would convert it to this form. And I can show how that works. So where was it? It was here. Yeah, so now, so we have this, we initially on the JavaScript side, we have this column-oriented version of the data set. This line here converts that column-oriented version to a row-oriented version of the same thing, such that it is now usable within the GIO controller object. The alternative is to do a conversion on the R side, and I'll talk about that in a couple of minutes. So if I get this code on, and then we do that again, and we do this because I can't view them in R. So now we've got a globe with the two arcs that are encoded in the data that I've passed in this arcs thing. I can look at the script, the, you know, the page. Hold on, where are we? Here. And this is the data in its kind of the form in which it's sent over to the browser by R. So this is the raw JSON that is sent over by R. This isn't its converted form, but div ID. Maybe you can't actually see. But what happens is that code, the x.data entry of that, gets passed into this function here and gets converted. So we should be able to, oh God, I didn't expect that. Where's my, right. If I take this, oh, if I copy that over first. Copy. Is that going to work? I'm not sure that's going to work, actually. Ah, yeah, okay. Okay, and then, so it would be y.x.data rather than, so if I take const x equals x, and then I can look at that. Come on. So we've got, this is the version of the data that's transferred by R. And then what we can do is call this function on that. So that should, HTML widgets data frame to D3, should convert it over so that there's an array, the first and second entries of, each of which is an object. That's so this function you can call in the console and you'll see what it can do. So we're converting it on the JavaScript side there. There's probably pros and cons to if this was a particularly big data set, it might make more sense to do it on the R side and transfer the kind of data set that had been serialized correctly rather than converting it on the browser side. What's the next step? The alternatives though. So rather than trying to convert a two-dimensional data frame into a one-dimensional object, and then, you know, complaining that it's not done it in the direction that you wanted. It might make sense to I didn't copy the code that they used in the book. It would be SApply along the first. Apply along one, right, okay. So so if you've got a data frame like this and you use apply on it, basically what happens is you can either apply over the rows, which is when you pass in one here, or over the columns and you pass in two. So if I can compare the two actually. So this is where you're iterating over the columns and you get the first and second entries of the E column, the first and second entries of the I column. If you do the same thing over the iterating over the rows, you end up with a list structure, each of which has an E, I, and V entry, which is more kind of consistent with what you'd want on that. In JavaScript, what was the function to convert that to JSON? To JSON, right? If I do that might fail. That generates a it actually generates an object, a kind of named object, so that's key value pairs rather than an array, but each of the elements within it, each of the kind of values, contains all the necessary information for a single arc. So that would transfer okay and be usable by GIL. The next way that you can make your data compatible with the library is to modify the tool used by HTML widgets such that it serializes your data the correct way. So by default, HTML widgets uses this function here, and embedded within HTML widgets, there's a bunch of arguments that have been chosen that may not be appropriate in all settings. So, for example, they use this data frame equals columns argument by default. And what that does is it creates this column-oriented object out of the data that we've set up. If we change that to data frame equals rows, if I do that over here, we get the something more akin to what is used in the GIO documentation. So it's again, it looks like an array of JavaScript objects. There is another function that was discussed later in the chapter from a different package called JSONify rather than JSONlite. And with that, that does a kind of row-oriented split up of the data by default. So it generates the data in the format we expect. So what you can actually do is you can either modify the function that's used by default by HTML widgets, you know, provide it different arguments, or you can replace it with an alternative function. You can to alter the serializer used by you. Basically, what you do is you modify attributes, and then through some kind of, you know, magic internally in HTML widgets, it will take the attributes for your for the X object that you pass in to create widgets. If that X object has an attribute that's to JSON args or to JSON func, those attributes will be used by HTML widgets to modify either the function arguments on one hand or the function itself that is used to serialize your data into JSON. So it's quite a neat way to pass, you know, to ensure that your data's encoded correctly. And the syntax to do that, so the syntax to do that, I'll just go back to my we are here transforming on the JS side, and then we're going to okay. So now, I've only put one of the examples of doing this. So here, we're adding an attribute to this list that says, when you come to use JSON Lite to JSON to encode the data that's inside the data element, make sure that you use the data frame equals rows argument when you call that, so it should behave like this when you do the transfer. So I'll just rebuild that. And
so Russ, I only asked the following because I know you like to dig into things, but do you know for HTML widgets, like why they made this choice? It kind of feels like a string as factors equals true kind of default that may not, I don't know, maybe kind of at loggerheads with most use cases, but perhaps I've just not looked at enough use cases to.
Yeah, I don't know why they chose to do it that way, but it does seem kind of unnatural from because I just imagine that on that most JavaScript libraries would be row oriented, so you'd have all the information for a data point from a given row, and in R, because of the, you know, tidyverse and everything, a lot of people have got used to storing you know, one observation as a given row and things, and so it does seem that the way HTML widgets is set up is contrary to the way the data will need to be encoded in most settings. I don't know why they made the decision, but what am I doing now? I was going to do this one. I could have typed it out in the time it took me to find the thing. There, right, and then we'll open that up. And so now, I think this is the most recent one. Now, when we look at the data that was transferred by R, we have the data is this array where each element within it has the information for a given arc, so it's been transferred to the correct form. So it's transferred on the R side, serialized into an appropriate data structure, and then that's sent over. If you've got a lot of data, there may be pros and cons to doing that on the R side versus on the browser side. I'm not entirely certain how much of a constraint the actual processing time would be, but the author makes a kind of the point that if you need to use this kind of code in your JavaScript scripts for an HTML widget, you have to call it everywhere you use. How would it work? It lends itself to constructing quite scruffy code at the end, because you might have to pepper this data conversion code throughout your JavaScript site, certainly if you're modifying multiple tables as part of one of the widgets that you're constructing. Whereas here, by setting a single argument that makes sure that your data frames are all encoded a particular way. You're just modifying a single place and ensuring that your data is all in the correct structure. Now, that might lead to some pain points, because if you know, if for some reason you need to transfer multiple tables, one might need to be column oriented and one might be row oriented, and that might be a source of complication. But the main kind of thing I got from the pros and cons section of this book was that the author was trying to kind of urge you to use the default serializer if at all possible, and if it's not possible, to modify it as conservatively as possible. So this kind of modification where you're just changing a single argument in the call to that serializer is probably conservative enough for our needs. The alternative is to replace wholesale the function that's used for serialization. So for example, you can do, did I include the code? Yes, you can include a function that you might set up yourself along with this attribute name. There is actually the HTML widgets vignettes on their website contain quite a bit of information about these functions for conversion from one format to another. So this, the data frame to D3 that was mentioned in the chapter, there's also this transpose array function. And they do mention modifications that you can make to that JSON serializer. Because as I was reading the book, I was thinking, if this book hadn't been written, there was no way I would have been able to have found in the documentation which attribute I need to modify to make sure that this thing works. And so I was quite surprised that the documentation was covered it here. And to be honest, even then, I think at the very end of the advanced vignette, I might have missed it anyway. But so there is documentation about this kind of stuff. Now, so we've ended up with a working version of the code where we can transfer data over, the data's in the correct format, and hence we can start building out the data that we want to transfer. We can start looking into additional things within GIO that we might want to control from R. So things like the look and feel of the images and things like that. There is a small section at the end of the chapter which I will not be talking about today because I have a very hard exit at the top of the hour. And it they talk about hold on, I'll get the book up. When I call this new GIO function here, that creates a kind of visualization object that's stored in R memory for now. So I can store that, assign it to a variable, and when I do that, it's much like with ggplot2. You can create a visualization, store it in an object, and if you store it in an object, it isn't necessarily printed to the screen immediately, or printed to your markdown that you're rendering or whatever. You have to effectively print the contents of that object for it to be for a visualization to be made. And as a result, so basically, we can look at the contents of G at the moment. So we have the data that's stored within it. We have, there'd be a width, I guess. What else would there be? Something. Dependencies. Ugh. Everything's null. But anyway, there's content within there that you can modify after generating the object. So it's much like where you can store a kind of intermediate plot object onto which you subsequently, when you're working with ggplot2, say, where you can subsequently add additional layers, additional metadata and stuff on top of. And then after you've subsequently modified the object, you can then print it out to the screen or whatever. It's the same kind of process. And as a result of that, they introduced some kind of styling functions here. So at present, there isn't any style. G dollar, I'm fairly certain at least. Yeah, it's null at the moment. So we could take the GIO object and here append some additional information that would determine what the chart, what the visualization will look like at the end of the day. So it's quite neat, but you need to modify the JavaScript side and things like that as well. And I haven't done that in the repo that I set up. But yes, it's quite neat. So it's working with base R graphics for such a long time was a huge source of frustration for me, because like you'd write loads of code and it would all plot immediately to the screen. And as such, it was always hard to kind of iteratively build up a figure in base graphics in a way that it wasn't in ggplot2. And you also leads to you having kind of more duplicated code and stuff. So it was quite nice to see that you can kind of modify these objects after you've initially constructed them. But that workflow provides you a way to kind of add additional stuff onto an HTML widget such that you can subsequently use it. But I haven't gone into it in any detail today. To be honest, the past three chapters, the examples have built up and they're a bit more complicated. But the chapters seemed quite samey to me. They seemed to be kind of teaching the same thing. So it was quite nice to see the complications that data structure can cause here. A little bit more about how to interact with the widget object once you've constructed it and things. But I didn't feel like I learned a great deal more than I learned last week when Ryan was presenting about how to set these things up. But but that was neat. I mean, this library, the stuff it can do, the visualizations are I don't know how intuitive they are, but they're very impressive to look at. I'm kind of really impressed. There was I remember seeing someone and they kind of created a kind of spherical representation of all the digitized music of the world, and you could kind of connect regions together in the same way. You could like navigate it as if it was on a globe, which was quite neat. But yeah, I've really not much experience with these kind of tools. I mean, I've made a lot of histograms in my time, but not quite so many plots over the top of a globe. So that was the chapter. I mean, it's been quite interesting. There's another couple of chapters coming up on HTML widgets, getting into more and more advanced topics. So for example, there's a little bit about how to share data between different widgets, and there's a little bit, that's the next, the chapter afterwards. And then there is a fine, so yeah, there's three more chapters in this section of the book. I mean, I'm quite happy to go through them all, but I don't know how, whether there might be diminishing returns at this end of this section of the book. We'll try and do chapter 8 next week as well, to see what additional stuff we can do. I think chapter 8 is a bit bigger than chapter 7, so we'll probably not do the whole.
I was going to ask that, Russ, if whether kind of you get the sense that chapter 8 might be best divided up. I mean, at the very least, it seems like a kind of a hot, a mix of disparate topics, at least kind of looking at the headings. I've not delved too much in the content yet. No.
We could do that. We could do that. Yeah. And particularly, I think chapter 10 is quite short. And maybe chapter 10 and chapter 9 could be done together. Chapter 9 is quite big as well. We'll think about it. We'll try and present the bulk of chapter 8 at least, or maybe half, 2/3 of it next week. Cool. Thanks for coming along. Sorry, it's just the two of us, but it's still good to do the book clubs from my perspective at least.
Likewise.
I feel quite confident about being able to build these things now, and I don't know whether it's just that the examples were kind of canned examples of, these are the problems you'll find. Dealing with the problems as they arise when you're actually working on things is a whole different kettle of fish. But anyway, I'm going to have to head off. Nice to see you again. I'll see you next week.
Thanks so much, Russ, for the tour. It's very helpful.
That's all right. Okay. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.